Welcome to January 14th, 1941. I'm Henry Chopp, your host. That was a Tuesday back in 1941, and we have about an hour's worth of vintage radio broadcast to share with you tonight. Before we get to any of that, let me give you a couple of reminders here. I do plan on uploading more frequently on this channel, therefore the dates on this channel will not match the dates on the newspaper channel because I cannot upload the newspaper readings as quickly as I can upload old-time radio. One of the old-time radio broadcasts takes little research and I could just put it up really, really quick and I could probably go to a 5 to 7 day a week upload, maybe even multiple times a day. We'll see how that goes, though. So I will try to upload more frequently on the old time radio channel. But speaking of the newspaper channel, there is a link in the description to this video. Go over to the newspaper channel and you can hear a pseudo newscast. What I mean by pseudo newscast, it is read by me. I read from the Chicago Tribune because I'm from the Chicago area. And I can relate to many of the local stories, but it's pretty neat to see a city grow with World War II. But you also get a lot of the big World War II and historic stories as well. The small stories, too, are very interesting as we go through the war. And there are something I just added on that channel. There are going to be pictures, too. I'm going to post pictures at the beginning of the video, maps, pictures of some of the news stories and, you know, whatever, and some ads, too, you'll get to see. So just some interesting stuff. Those will change, too, as the war goes on. So very, very interesting and cool things on there. Let me get back to the more frequent uploads really quick. I'm working on getting my 1938 and 39 old-time radio programs back in my computer. I'm putting them back in chronological order in a playlist on my computer, and I will once again do some of those dates as well as we go through the World War II years. I will start at January 1st, 1938. I did previously have those programs up on YouTube. But this time I will do them with a little bit of narration and, you know, similar to what a regular program is. Back then, back in 2018 when I started my old channel, which I really don't think is coming back, I didn't do any narration on, well, I wasn't on mic, so to speak. And it'll be kind of nice to be on mic consistently through all of these. But I will start in chronological order with 1938 while continuing 1941. So it will be kind of a fun thing to do. And eventually everything will merge together. And you know what? You could find us on Facebook. The Facebook page title is the World War II News and Old Time Radio Channel on YouTube. And on there I share many articles that have to from other YouTube pages Facebook pages that have to do with World War II or radio or just general culture from the years 1938 to 1945. I think you will find some of the stuff interesting in there. I'm a member of a lot of World War II groups and such on Facebook and a ton of old-time radio groups on Facebook, and I could share, you know, what I can. It'll be sort of like a Reader's Digest, how Reader's Digest shares articles from several different sources. And every once in a while, I'll post my own picture or some of the, you know, whenever there's a radio upload. Well, if you click the bell icon, you'll get notifications, but I'll also post it in the on the Facebook page, too. So go look for the World War II News and Old Time Radio Channel on YouTube. And some of the articles are very educational that I share from other pages, too. So I think you'll think it's pretty cool. All right, let me tell you what we have coming up tonight. Well, we only have 1 hour worth of radio broadcast, and unfortunately, I was not able to find a Fibber McGee and Molly program. Fibber McGee and Molly were aired on Tuesdays. I used several different sources to locate programs, and for some reason, the Fibber McGee and Molly program from January 14th, 1941 is not around. So I do not have that And the only program that I have that's dated January 14th, 41 was Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy. And that aired at 5:30 in the evening over NBC Blue. But I did place two programs that are just dated 1941 on here. And one of them is a WPA concert, the Works Progress Administration. Those of you who know history know that the Works Progress Administration was established by the federal government during the Great Depression to put people to work in their trades when they were not getting hired by private industry. And they used the arts, too, as well. Many of your post offices or federal buildings or schools from the that were built in the 1930s were built through this program. And many murals were painted and things like that. But we have here a New York City Symphony concert, 15 minutes long over the it was syndicated over. So it's a pretty cool program in these dying days of the Great Depression. Actually, in my opinion, for all intents and purposes, the Great Depression was pretty much dead by this point in time, with all the defense industry popping up all over the country. So jobs were starting to get to be plentiful right now. And then the next program we have is a Bulldog Drummond episode from 1941. This episode is titled Ride in the Moonlight. Now, I do have the audition program from Bulldog Drummond, so this episode likely did not air this early in the year in 1941. The audition, I think I'd have to go through my files and take a look for sure, but I think it was dated August 15th of 41. But I wanted to give you guys something to listen to besides two 15-minute programs. I like to try to, if at all possible, make each upload contain at least 1 hour of vintage radio programs if I can. So Bulldog Drummond was a great detective program. I think you'll enjoy this. It runs about 25 minutes long, no commercials. I'm not sure if it was syndicated or not, or if it was just I don't know. Anyway, Bulldog Drummond lasted all through the old time radio years from 1941 on up. So it is a great program. You'll love it. I see the dials glowing on this old tube radio. Let's listen to Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy.
Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy.
Wave the flag for Hudson High, boys. Show them how we stand. Every shot our TV champions, known throughout the land.
Wheaties, breakfast of champions, bring you the thrilling adventures of Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy. Say, when the records show you that two different basketball teams both seem to have the same power and speed and playing ability, which team do you cheer for? Well, it's my guess that you'll be giving your support to the team you like best. And right there, you have a perfect system for picking a real champion training breakfast for yourself this time of year. When you make up your mind to eat a training breakfast of whole wheat, the nourishing grain recommended in the winter diet of many great athletes, you'll want to know whether you should take that whole wheat breakfast in hot cook form or in a tempting, crunchy, ready-to-eat form like those toasted flakes called Wheaties. Well, here's the answer for you, straight from headquarters. In the first place, we find that the heat of cooking doesn't count for a thing at helping to keep you warm in chilly weather. It's the number of fuel energy units a food gives you that's most important. And listen to this. Wheaties hand you the same number of these valuable fuel energy units to help keep you warm as you'd get from an equal amount of whole wheat served steaming hot from the kitchen stove. You see? That leaves the choice of your whole wheat training breakfast for winter strictly up to you. If you've been eating Wheaties for breakfast, if you prefer the champion flavor of those good whole wheat flakes, you can go right on enjoying your Wheaties all winter long without having to switch over even once to a hot cooked breakfast. Now I'm asking you, isn't that the kind of a break a fellow or girl could want? You help yourself to a big bowl full of nourishing whole wheat. Just the kind of food champion athletes need to help them keep on the go. And with that fine whole wheat nourishment, you're getting all the extra special goodness of those crunchy Wheaties flakes.
all the keen flavor and real satisfaction you'd expect in a champion training breakfast these winter mornings. You'd better put in your bid for Wheaties right now. Eat them with lots of milk or cream and a glass of fruit juice. That's a real athlete's fuel energy breakfast, a genuine breakfast of champions. And it's yours to enjoy the minute you get those Wheaties. And now, Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy. Jack, Billy, Betty, and Uncle Jim are pushing ahead along a rough trail in the wild Zamboanga hill country of Mindanao. Michelle, their Filipino friend, is leading the way with a pack horse that carries their supplies and equipment. They're going to the village of Molita to find an old Moro peddler who knows something of the missing Professor Loring. And they suspect this peddler of having a hand in a threatened uprising among the tribes. Jack and Uncle Jim know that their progress has been observed by watchers stationed in the hills, and they're keeping a close eye on the trail ahead. Right now, they are approaching a questionable fork in the trail, and they are deciding which fork to take.
Listen. This fork in the trail looks like all the other forks we've passed, Jack. Which one do we take, the right or the left?
Wait a minute, Billy. I'll unhook the pedometer from my belt and see what it reads. Here, it says exactly 3.5 miles.
Then we bear right here, Jack. Take the right fork, Michelle. You can persuade the pack horse to go that way.
All right, Captain Derryfield. We go right.
My guess that we'd be in a pickle if we didn't have that pedometer.
It certainly helps, Betty. Of course, if we didn't have it, we could figure out some way to know where we were.
But, Jack, we might figure wrong. We might have turned to the right on the wrong fork and be really lost. With the pedometer, we know exactly where we are.
That's right, and I'll bet the natives who are watching this trail know exactly where we are.
They ought to. We've seen two or three of them on the hilltop signaling down to the village.
But, Jack, why should they keep such a close watch on this trail?
I can make a pretty good guess, Betty. If the natives of Melita are stirring up all this unrest among the tribes, they'd want to be mighty careful as to who came to their village.
Well, of course they would, Betty.
And if any rifles and ammunition have been smuggled into this village, you can bet the natives of the village wouldn't want the soldiers to make a surprise raid on them.
And they'd watch this trail especially, since it's the trail that the soldiers from Pettit Barracks would use.
I wish that old Moro peddler had stayed in Zamboanga. Then we wouldn't have had to come into this wild country to find out about Professor Loring.
But jumping Jiminy, Betty, the fact that this Moro peddler is in Melita shows that he may have something to do with all this trouble. And that shows that he may be an agent of Sultan Baloa. And if Baloa is holding Professor Loring prisoner, then this Moro peddler may know all about Professor Loring.
That's using your imagination, Billy. Anyway, we do know that this Moro peddler had Professor Loring's watch, so he must know something about Professor Loring.
I shouldn't wonder if he stole the watch from the professor, Uncle Jim.
It's more likely that it was given to him by the chief of the tribe that captured Professor Loring.
The trail takes a sharp turn ahead, Uncle Jim. I think I'll run ahead and take a look-see before the rest of you get there. We don't want to be taken by surprise.
That's a good idea, Jack. I'll go up ahead with you. Michelle, wait a minute. Billy, you wait here with Betty until Jack and I see what lies around the bend in the trail.
All right, Uncle Jim. And Jack, be careful of that walkie-talkie radio set on your back. It may come off when you run.
Not this set, Billy. It's strapped on too well. Come on, Uncle Jim. We'll see if there's an ambush.
Move your pack horse to one side of the trail, Michelle. We're coming by.
Pull over, horse. Pull over there. Where do you go, Senor Jack?
We're just going ahead to see around the bend in the trail, Michelle. You wait here till we give the all-clear signal.
I don't think there's any danger, Jack, but it's just as well to make sure. We seem to be getting involved in a lot more than we figured on at first.
Here, Uncle Jim. Here's a thick cluster of bushes just where the trail turns. We can look out from behind those bushes.
We'll do that, Jack. If I remember that map correctly, this trail should be dropping down to the creek pretty soon.
It does drop down to the creek, Uncle Jim. Why, we're almost there.
Well, that creek's pretty broad, too.
But look, Uncle Jim. There's a kind of suspension bridge across the creek. Imagine seeing a suspension bridge here.
It's a native suspension bridge, Jack. See, it's made up of heavy vines woven together. But you'd never get a horse on that bridge. We'll have to swim the pack horse across.
Boy, I hope he can swim.
All of the army horses are taught to swim creeks, Jack.
But what about his packs? Won't our equipment get wet?
We can strap them on top of the pack carrier so they won't get wet when he swims across.
Look, Uncle Jim. Look up the trail on the far side of the creek. Isn't there someone about halfway up the hill watching us?
Where, Jack? Oh, I see him. Standing near that large tree. I don't think he sees us yet. He's just watching the trail.
I wonder what he'll do when he does see us.
Well, we might as well find out, Jack. He's got to see us eventually. Let's step out of the bushes and let him see us.
All right, Uncle Jim. We'll watch him and see what he does.
There. He sees us now. He's waiting to see how many of us there are.
Look, Uncle Jim, he's turned around. He's signaling to somebody further up the hill.
The natives certainly have this trail under observation. But we aren't the people they're watching for, Jack. I believe they're on the lookout for the soldiers of Pettit Barracks.
If the soldiers did come to search the village, Uncle Jim, I bet they wouldn't find a single suspicious thing. If there were any arms or ammunition there, they'd all be hidden somewhere else before the soldiers could arrive.
There's no doubt about that, Jack. You may as well signal Billy and the others to come along.
Wait, Uncle Jim, this is a dandy chance to try out that walkie-talkie radio set Colonel Brewster gave us. And wait till I get this mic out of the pocket of the set. There. Now pull out this rod antenna.
Billy sees what you're doing, Jack. He's getting his set ready to talk, too.
Of course, this is no real distance at all, but we'll see how it sounds. Hey, Billy, are you listening?
I'm listening, Jack. What can you see around the trail?
This is spooky, Uncle Jim. Billy's voice seems to be coming from the small of my back.
I heard that, too, Jack. Why, I bet I can even read yourself with this walkie-talkie, if you think out loud. Is anybody in sight around the trail?
The trail drops down to a creek, Billy. There's a native on the trail on the other side of the creek, halfway up the hill. He signaled to somebody else that he saw us.
Is it all right to come ahead, Jack?
Yeah, Uncle Jim says to come on ahead. And say, you'd better be prepared to get wet. We've got to swim the pack horse across the creek.
Swim it feel mighty good now. I'm signing off, Jack. We'll be right along.
Okay, signing off. Uncle Jim, shall we go down to the creek? We can pick out a good place to swim the horse across.
We'll do that, Jack. I shouldn't wonder if we have some company before we get across that creek.
Company? You mean...
I mean I saw that native wave his arm as if to signal someone to come on.
Then there must be a bunch of men on the other side of the creek, somewhere up the hillside.
I think there are, Jack. Remember, we're getting pretty close to the village now. If they're on the alert, they'll want to know who we are before we get across this creek.
I hope that old Moro peddler doesn't learn who we are before we get a chance to speak to him. He'll certainly take to his heels if he does.
I don't think he'll try to get away. If he's mixed up with this trouble, he'll be sure to stick around to see who we are. Well, there's the creek.
It looks pretty swift, Uncle Jim. Do you think the horse can make it all right?
He'll be carried downstream a little ways before he can get across. You and Billy and I'll have to see that he makes it somehow.
There comes Michelle and the pack horse now, Uncle Jim. And there's Billy and Betty.
Yes, and there's another native halfway up the hill on the other side of the creek, Jack. The tribe's beginning to assemble. Let's stop now.
Well, they're not really afraid of an attack yet, or they'd have cut this suspension bridge. Say, this is some bridge. It's darn clever the way they've used the vines to hold it up.
They've made a very good suspension cable from those vines, Jack. See how they've twisted them together for the main cable?
We can let Betty go across on the bridge, Uncle Jim. No use her getting all wet, too. And she can take the walkie-talkie sets and my pedometer. We don't want those things getting wet.
Should say we don't. Come on, Michelle. They've got to swim that horse across.
We'll be there soon, Captain Teddy Fish.
Captain Jiminy Jack, are we going to swim the horse across that creek?
That's just what we're going to do, Billy.
Too bad he isn't a trick horse. We could take him across that homemade suspension bridge.
Well, that bridge was put there just for Betty.
Listen to the horse. He doesn't want to swim that creek, Jackie. He's telling me he doesn't want to.
And he's certainly making himself heard. But he'll swim it.
Jump on Jiminy. Look across the creek, Betty. Over there where the trail goes up the hillside. There are two natives just standing there watching.
Oh, I see him, Billy. What are they going to do, Jack?
I hope they're not going to do anything, Betty. Uncle Jim thinks there'll soon be a bunch of natives here.
Gee, Willikins, I hope they're friendly natives.
I don't know how friendly they'll be, Billy, but I don't think they'll try to harm us. The soldiers managed to keep these tribesmen in order in this part of the country.
Here, Betty, you take this pedometer and these portable radio packs, too. You'll have to carry them across the bridge to keep them dry.
All right, Jack. You and Billy take the walkie-talkies off your back. Here, I'll help you unstrap them.
Michelle and I'll rearrange these supply packs on the horse while you're doing that, Jack. Here, Michelle, lend me a hand with the shirt single. We've got to readjust the pack carrier. We don't want these packs to get wet when we come across.
Me had them coppers in Fairfield, but me no think horse will swim cross creek.
If he's been in the army long, he will, Michelle.
But these deep creek coppers in Fairfield, these very sweet creek. Me no think horse will like.
Well, we'll soon find out.
Are you all ready, Uncle Jim?
Just about, Jack. You'd better lead the horse into the water. You made friends with him with those lumps of sugar. Billy, you swim along on the downstream side of him. If he tries to turn around, head him off.
I'll try, Uncle Jim, but I'd rather try to swim the English Channel than to get this horse across that stream.
Well, it may not be as hard as you think, Billy. Come on, old fella. Let's see if you'll follow me into the creek.
Well, there's your answer, Jack. Look at those ears go back.
Yeah, but he's coming, Billy. He's coming slowly. Watch how he tests the creek bottom before he puts each foot down.
You're doing fine, Jack. To get him in, you and Billy stay on that side of him. Michelle and I'll stay on this side.
He's actually going into the creek. But look, Jack, there's another native on the other side of the creek. That makes three of them.
Never mind the natives, Billy. We've got to get this horse across. There, look at him. He's swimming. Stick with him, Billy. Put one hand on the pack carrier as you swim along.
Hey, he is swimming, but this current is taking us downstream pretty fast.
Watch it, Jack. He's trying to turn around.
Hey, whoa there. You're going the wrong way. We're going across this creek.
Hammer you.
Now, get that head around and point right.
He's coming around.
Oh, yes.
There.
Yeah, that's more like it.
He's heading right now. We'll soon be across. Watch that pack on your side, Billy. It's slipping a little.
I'll try to hold it up, Uncle Jim, but it's going to get a little wet. There, I guess it won't slide anymore.
Billy, this creek must come from way up in the hill. Did you ever feel anything so nice and cool?
Yeah, and those natives on the other side of the creek must come from way up in the hill, too.
And they may look cool, but they don't look nice. They've got barongs and all sorts of hardware with them, too.
Well, that may not mean a thing. When you get up in these hills, everyone has some sort of knife on them. Hooray, it's getting shallow. Look, the horse is walking now. Yeah, we're just about across, Billy.
I know it, Jack, and I wish we were back on the other side. Look up the trail. There's a whole flock of natives now, and they're coming down here toward us.
Well, they got the pack horse across the stream all right, but what next? There's a flock of tribesmen from the village coming down to meet them. And there's more than an even chance that they're not especially glad to see Jack and Uncle Jim and the others. But you can bet that Jack and Uncle Jim aren't going to turn around and go back until they find that old Moro peddler. Be sure to listen in at the same time tomorrow to another thrilling episode of the Zamboanga Adventure with Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy. Now, have you got the Wheaties all lined up for your breakfast of champions tomorrow morning? A big bowl full of those extra good whole wheat flakes, lots of milk or cream, and a glass of fruit juice. That's your all-year-round breakfast of champions. The right breakfast for you every morning.
Have you tried Wheaties? They're whole wheat with all the brand.
This is Franklin McCormick saying goodbye until tomorrow for General Mills, makers of Wheaties, breakfast of champions, who have just presented another episode of Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy.
So just buy Wheaties, the best breakfast food in the land. Wave the flag for Hudson High, boys. Show them how.
May we now present a transcribed program by the New York City Symphony under the leadership of Eugene Plotnikoff. This orchestra is a unit of the National WPA Music Program, directed by Dr. Earl V. Moore. For the first portion of the program, we have selected music from Tchaikovsky's sextet, Souvenir de Florence. This sextet belongs to the category of chamber music. It was written in one of the composer's rare veins of happiness and serenity. We will now hear the first section of the Adagio Cantabile, arranged for string orchestra. We pause in our program at this point to bring you a brief talk by the Honorable T.V. Smith, Congressman at Large from Illinois, Professor of Philosophy at the University of Chicago, lecturer and writer, and the founder of the Coast to Coast Sunday afternoon radio roundtable discussion. Congressman Smith.
Neglect of the unemployed gives thoughtful people conscience trouble, leaving in its wake a sense of guilt. We know that men are more important than money. We Americans of all people know this. But we haven't yet fully made up our minds to put men before money and thus keep first things first. Hence the widespread sense of guilt, which impairs united effort and seeks insistently for a scapegoat. We can forearm ourselves, however, by beholding with clearer eyes the trinity of our guilt. First, our Christian conscience hurts us. Why? Let Christians recall this text, recall and understand. Whoso hath this world's goods and seeth his brother have need and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? Second, our democratic conscience hurts us. Why? Let patriots hear this text, hear and understand. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Third, our industrial conscience hurts us. Why? Let all citizens hear this text, hear and understand. It comes from the mayor of one of our large cities, Mayor Burton of Cleveland. The crisis that remains is an industrial and manufacturing crisis. WPA work relief is especially well suited to this need. The working habits of these men are at the foundation of American industry. It would be an industrial tragedy, both from the point of view of the public and of the workers themselves, to throw away their productive time and capacity. Unquote. This, then, is the trinity of our common guilt as touching the unemployed. Guilty discipleship, guilty citizenship, guilty workmanship. And the guilt of neglected workmanship is the greatest of our guilts. This neglect it is which the WPA exists to cure. Let us support this effort as long as need be, therefore, in the larger faith that those who bear one another's burdens double their own joy and cut their guilt in two.
Thank you, Congressman Smith. Our orchestra continues now with the second portion of the Adagio Cantabile movement from Tchaikovsky's sextet Souvenir de Florence. Thank you. Thus, we bring to a close this transcribed program by the New York City Symphony Orchestra. These musicians have been employed by the Work Projects Administration to maintain their skill and to provide education and entertainment for the public.
Into his American adventures comes Bulldog Drummond.
Come with me to North Beach, one of the finest beaches in the Atlantic. Famous for its swimming, sports, and for Wynn's Wonderland, a gay, exciting sportland without equal. Anthony Wynn, an old friend of mine from Mayfair, had opened his fun palace on the Sound, a short run out of the city. That evening, a gay crowd had gathered. They'd come for thrills or laughter.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Wynn's Wonderland on the Sound, the greatest playland, the greatest thrill land in the East. Come closer, ladies and gentlemen. See the greatest thrill ride in America, the fastest, craziest, the most thrilling roller coaster ride in the world. The Whirlwind, the tenth part of a dollar, ladies and gentlemen. 10 cents to ride with the wind, to feel the thrill of flying, to live dangerously. Step right up to the fastest place.
All up, end of the ride. All right, mister, this is the end of the line, all up. Hey, mister. Hey, Barker. Barker, come here, something's the matter with this guy here.
Now, what's going on here?
Hey, look, mister, you have to get off or pay for another ride. Hey, can you hear me? Hey, stand back, please, don't cry.
Hey, what's the matter with him?
This man is dead. Hey, move back there, let me get him off. Now, wait a minute. Jump on you, hold it. It's Mr. Wynn, the owner of the place.
Captain Drummond speaking.
Oh, Captain Drummond, thank goodness I reached you.
This is Isabel Wynn. Do you remember Anthony Wynn's daughter?
Anthony Wynn? Why, of course, Miss Wynn. How are you? It's been 2 years since I've seen you. How's father?
Captain Drummond, something terrible has happened.
What is it?
My father. He's dead.
Dead?
Yes, they say it was an accident, but I know better. It was murder. Somebody killed my father.
Murder? Now, Miss Wynn, tell me as simply as you can what happened.
I don't know. I saw father only a half hour ago, and he was fine then. And then they told me that he'd been riding on the roller coaster, and they found him in his seat, dead.
But what makes you think it's murder?
Father didn't just die. I know he didn't. Somebody killed him, Captain Drummond. And you've got to help me. You've got to come out here.
Now, Miss Wynn, I'll do whatever I possibly can. Benny and I'll leave immediately. Yes. Tell me, where are you now?
At the Wonderland, out at North Beach.
All right. Now, please try to steady yourself. Hold tight until we get there. And, Miss Wynn, don't tell anyone you think your father's death was murder. Miss Wynn, are you sure you're all right?
Yes, Captain Drummond. I was upset when I spoke to you, but I'm all right now. Really, I am.
You're very brave, Miss Wynn, very brave.
But this is Miller, or Barker, Captain Drummond. He's the man who first found father.
How do you do, Miller? Now, can you tell me exactly what happened?
Well, the roller coaster came in at the end of the ride, and I saw someone lying slumped over in his seat. I didn't know it was Mr. Wynn until I went over and picked him up. And there he was, Captain Drummond, dead.
How was he lying?
Well, like I said, slumped over, his head down on his chest, way over on the right side of the car.
What was Mr. Wynn doing on that ride?
Well, I guess he was testing it.
What do you mean, testing it?
Well, he did it every week, just about this time. He'd always take the ride himself to see if the whirlwind was in good condition. He's been doing it for years.
Yes, that's right, Captain Drummond. Father said he'd never ask a patron to ride on the coaster if he himself wouldn't ride on it.
Hmm. But why should this ride have killed him, then?
I don't know, Captain. The doctor here said it was his heart.
Well, it's true. Father's health was never good. And recently, he'd taken a turn for the worse. Miller and I finally persuaded him to see a doctor about it. We drove in together yesterday. And the doctor said to avoid overstrain and sudden shock.
Miss Wynn, I never saw your father get on a whirlwind. If I had, I'd have stopped him.
Yes, I know you would, Miller. Thank you.
Well, Miller, you've been very helpful. I think you'd better get back to your work now. The crowd seems a little jittery, upset by the accident. See what you can do to quiet them.
All right, I'll do my best, Captain Drummond. If you should need me, I'll be glad to help.
Miss Wynn, I don't like to ask you this again, but what makes you think your father was murdered?
I made him promise me yesterday, after we'd seen the doctor, that he wouldn't go on the whirlwind again. And he said that he'd let Miller test it in the future. But Captain Drummond's father didn't go on that ride voluntarily.
Hmm. Had your father any enemies here?
Enemies? No. Except perhaps Mr. Carlson, but... No, I wouldn't say they were enemies.
Mr. Carlson?
Yes, he's the owner of the large oyster house a few piers down on the Sound. You see that neon sign on the yacht out there in the bay?
Where?
No, there. That ship anchored just beyond the jetty.
Oh, yes, I see. Carlson's oysters are in season. Pretty color that sign makes.
That's it. He's a sort of competitor of father's. He runs a resort on the Jersey coast. And he made us an offer to buy out the Wonderland a few days ago, but my father wouldn't sell. They had some words about it, but nothing serious.
I see. Did he threaten your father?
Oh, no. No, nothing like that. Why, Captain Drummond, you don't think...
I don't think anything yet, Miss Wynn. I'm just asking questions. And the next thing I want to know is how to take a ride on the roller coaster. Denny and I are going for a trip on the whirlwind.
Are you all right back there, Denny?
Oh, yes, sir. This is quite a ride, sir. Quite a daring ride.
You're right. That last dip was very steep. Steep enough, I'd say, to kill a man with a weak heart.
You mean, sir, you believe Mr. Wynn was really killed?
I'm not sure yet. Oh, wait, don't move, Denny.
What's that, sir?
Don't move. Now tell me, where are you sitting?
Why, here, sir. Back here, on the left side of the seat.
That's it, on the left side of the seat. That last dip curved sharply to the right. The speed of the roller coaster would naturally throw us both to the left.
Naturally, sir.
I purposely sat alone in the front seat, Denny, with you in the seat behind me, to see what would happen.
Well, I'm sorry to be dull, sir, but I don't see what you're driving at.
Miller, the barker, told us that he found Wynn's body slumped over in the front seat on the right-hand side of the car. That means he couldn't possibly have been on that ride alone. Otherwise, that last dip would have thrown him over to the left the way it did us.
Then he wasn't alone, sir, when he took that fatal ride.
No. Someone rode alongside of him. Someone who knew he had a weak heart and knew he couldn't stand the shock of that last drop. Someone who forced him on that ride.
Then you mean, sir...
That Miss Wynne was right. Her father didn't die accidentally. Mr. Wynne was murdered on his own roller coaster. Well, Isabel, you were right.
Then father was murdered, Captain Drummond.
Yes. Someone forced him on that roller coaster, knowing the sharp curves and drops would be too much for his heart.
Why?
Well, who would want to do that, sir? I don't know yet. Now, Isabel, I want you to tell me what other attractions you have here at Wonderland.
Well, we have a shooting gallery here, as you see.
Yes. And what's down there?
Well, just past the shooting range, over to the left, you can see the hurling alley. Then there's a carousel across the road. Why, what are you after, Captain Drummond?
I don't know yet. I'm just getting an idea. Go on.
That's about all. Except for the whirlwind and the ride in the moonlight.
Ride in the moonlight? What's that?
Oh, it sounds very romantic, sir.
It is. It's a kind of modern old mill built right out into the water. Your boy and a girl like a boat ride in the moonlight. Well, we fixed up some boats with outboard motors, and the couples take them out on the sound.
I'd like to see that ride, Isabel.
It's just around the corner here, but I don't think you'll find it very exciting, Captain.
You can't tell.
Well, there it is. Ride in the moonlight. See, the boats leave through that passageway on the right, and they ride under a tunnel for about 50 yards, and then they're out in the sound. The route beyond the tunnel is marked by buoys, and you run along the sound for about a minute, and then back through another tunnel to the start.
Very ingenious.
It sounds very attractive.
It's very popular, too.
Isabel, would you care to take a ride in the moonlight with me? With me and Denny, of course.
Why, yes, Captain Drummond, if you think it worthwhile.
I do.
Ah, here's a boat, sir. It's called the Rhoda. You see, all the boats have names. It's a very pretty craft, if I may say so.
All right, the Rhoda will do.
Oh, excuse me, sir, Miss Wynne, but the Rhoda's out of commission. We got to overhaul her. Why not take this boat, the Mary Ann? She's in ship-shape condition and just as comfortable.
Very well, the Mary Ann it is. Give the motor a turn, will you, Denny?
Right, sir. Ah, ready, sir. Here we go. I say, sir, it's quite dark in this tunnel.
That seems to be the idea, Denny.
We'll be out on the sound in just a minute now. You haven't noticed anything yet, have you? I mean, anything out of the ordinary?
No, everything seems to be in order.
The motor, sir. I think it backfired.
That wasn't backfired, Denny. That was a gunshot. Keep low, Isabel. Someone's watching us. Someone's anxious to keep us from learning something. I'll be back in a moment to continue my story. Denny and I discovered that Anthony Wynne, an old friend of mine, was murdered. His accidental death due to heart failure was no accident, but a coldly planned killing. And in our search for the killer, Denny and I were in one of the little ride-in-the-moonlight boats with Isabel, Anthony's daughter. In the darkness of the tunnel, a shot rang out. Keep low, Isabel. Someone's watching us. Someone's anxious to keep us from learning something. Denny, can you speed up that motor?
I'll try, sir. No, I can't. It's set at a fixed speed.
All right, we'll just have to hug the bottom, then. Keep down, both of you. Hold on. What's that?
What, sir?
The Carlton sign on his yacht there. The oysters are in season sign. See it?
Yes. Flashing off and on. I never saw that before.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10 flashes.
What do you make of it, sir?
Denny, what time is it?
Oh, it's hard to make out in this light, sir. It's just 15 minutes before 10 o'clock, sir.
10 o'clock, that's it. I think I've got it. Well, they're going to work faster than I thought.
What do you mean, Captain Drummond?
We've got to get back to shore. Denny and I are going to Carlton's oyster bar. We're going to investigate some oysters on the half shell.
Captain Drummond,
Let's move over to the oyster bar, Denny. Is it 10 yet?
Almost, sir. It's about 3 minutes before the hour.
Keep your eyes open.
For what, sir?
Anything unusual? Denny.
Yes, sir.
That man there at the oyster bar.
The one taking the box of oysters, sir?
Yes. Because I heard him order a dozen oysters to take out. Let's move over and I'll stumble against him. I'll try to knock the package out of his hand. See if you can get one of those oysters.
I'll try, sir.
Excuse me, sir. Could you spare me a match?
You clumsy fool!
Oh, I say, I'm dreadfully sorry. Really, I am here. Let me help you pick them up.
Get away from here! Get away, you stumbling idiot! Leave those oysters alone! Don't you touch them! I'll kill you! I don't want your help! Get out of my way, you fool! You bumbling fool!
Good work, Denny.
Yeah, what a fainted temper. There must be something the matter with that man.
Did you get one?
Did you see that man, sir? He turned purple with rage. I never saw anything like it in my life.
Yes, yes, I saw him, Denny. And I think I know why. You did get one of the oysters, didn't you?
Oh, yes, I did, sir. And most amazing, sir, these oysters aren't opened. I never heard of anyone ordering unopened oysters before, did you, sir?
Not unless they aren't to be eaten.
What do you mean, Captain Drummond?
I'll know in a moment. Give me that oyster, Denny. No, not here. Come over to the corner. I want to open it.
Open it, sir?
Give me a knife. Thank you. There, that does it.
Well, that isn't an oyster, sir.
No, Denny. There's a small white package in between these oyster shells.
What do you make of it, sir?
Come on, I'll tell you as we go. We haven't a moment to waste. We're going for another ride on the Mary Ann. Another exciting ride in the moonlight.
Well, what about that oyster, sir?
Dope, Denny.
Dope, sir?
Yes. The oyster house is merely a blind for dope peddling. They take oysters, open them slightly, remove the meat, put in the drug, and close the shells again. I thought it was odd for a man to come up to the oyster bar and order a dozen oysters in season to take out. One doesn't ask for oysters in season, unless one means something besides oysters.
Oh, I see, sir. And that man I encountered, he must have been a purchaser.
That's why he was so furious when I bumped into him. That man was an addict. You notice his face? Horrible tenseness of his eyes and the stiffness of his body?
Yes, I did. He seemed almost ready to kill me, sir.
And he might have, if he'd seen you take an oyster. Such men are desperate, and they'll stand for no interference. Denny, it was this that Mr. Wynne discovered before he was killed.
You mean they found out that Mr. Wynne knew of their traffic in the foul drug, eh, sir?
Exactly. And Carlson, knowing Mr. Wynne had a weak heart, forced him to ride on the whirlwind, thereby murdering him.
Yes, but how could Carlson know that, sir?
Miller, the barker. You remember he drove Miss Wynne and her father in to see the doctor yesterday?
Then Miller mixed in it, too. I said, Captain Drummond, where are you taking the boat? You're not following the buoys. You're going out further into the sound.
We're taking a detour, Denny. We're going to visit Carlson's yacht. I suspect it's much more than an advertisement for the oyster house and much more than a yacht. All right, Denny, shut off the motor. We'll glide in. I don't want to broadcast our approach.
Right, sir.
Look, Denny, that boat there.
Why, it's the rudder, sir. But the starter told us it was out of working order.
Yes, out of working order for us. But an important part in Carlton's plan.
What do you mean, sir?
Never mind right now. Let's get up these steps and aboard. Walk quietly, Denny.
There's no need to be quiet, Captain Drummond. We've been expecting you.
Carlson?
Yes, Captain Drummond, Carlson. I'm flattered you should know me without an introduction. Oyster house owner, yachtman, and as you have so ably demonstrated, smuggler. But right now, on the business end of a gun. Get up here, quick. Bully.
Very clever, Carlson.
Now, back over there to that door. We couldn't understand why you took so long in getting here. Perhaps the Mary Ann was too slow. You should have tried the rotor. She's much faster, as your charming friend Miss Wynne can tell you.
Miss Wynne? Is she?
Yes. I took the precaution of inviting Miss Wynne to my yacht. We will say that she is my guest. She occupies the cabin here. Not a very willing guest, I might add, but nevertheless a guest.
I warn you, Carlson, if you harm Miss Wynne...
Now, look, Drummond, I give the orders here. Now, open that door.
There are no steps, and be quick about it. We'll open that door and get inside. Now, this is the anchor room, Drummond. The room in which the anchor chain piled when we left anchor. You see the windlass there and the chain attached. I'm sorry it's not very comfortable. And when we hoist anchor, you may find it a bit overcrowded. But you won't mind it for long. We take off at 11:05. Just about to pull anchor.
You know this is murder, don't you, Carlson? First Wynn, and now us.
Wynn? Murder? Oh, well, that was heart failure, Drummond. Heart failure. You heard the doctor's report. And as for you, I didn't know you'd stowed away on my boat. And I never thought you'd hide in the anchor chain room. Your accidental death will come as a shock to me, Captain. A great blow. Well, I see you're hoisting anchor. Goodbye, Captain Drummond.
The door, Denny. Let's see if we can move it. Now it's no use. 2 inches of steel.
The chain is beginning to fill up the room, sir.
We've got to stop it. We've got to find something to keep that chain from piling in here.
Quick, Denny, come around here. Give me a hand with this pipe. Coming, sir.
One chance in 10,000, Denny, but we've got to take it. This steam pipe here may provide the power for hoisting the anchor. There must be a steam winch somewhere here, and I think this pipe is it.
No, sir, watch it, Denny.
Pipe is made to drive steam. Here, take this rag. Wrap it around your hands and pull this way toward me when I say so.
Right, sir. I'm ready.
All right, then. Pull.
Bending. Now, once more, together. Pull. Watch out, Denny. That live steam will fall. Just behind it. I say you've done it, sir. The anchor stopped moving.
Hand me that splinter door, will you, Denny?
Yes, sir.
Now, if I can force this piece of rag into the pipe with a stick, I'll be able to plug up that seam. Give me a hand, Denny, but watch out for the seam. Good. Now, help me bend this pipe in the direction of the door. They'll be down in a minute to find out what's wrong, and we'll be able to greet them properly.
That's got it. Now, stand back, Denny.
What's going on in there? Come on, get out of there, both of you.
Miller, here's something you didn't expect. That's got it, Denny. The force of that steam is like a blow in the head. Miller's out. Get his gun.
Like that. Now, help me plug up this pipe. We've got to get on deck.
Sooner we get up on deck, the quicker we'll get to Carson.
All right, Drummond, your little escape is over. Drop that gun. Very clever stopping that anchor. Now, get over there, both of you. Back up against that cabin. It looks as if my anchor method was a little too subtle for you. I gotta use the crudest method of all to get rid of you. A bullet through your head.
You'll never get away with this, Carson.
Now, save the talk. Now, who wants it first? You, Drummond, or you?
Good work, Miss Wynn. Get those guns, Denny.
I've got them, sir. Now, up with your hands, Carlson. Up with them, I say.
Why, you...
Never mind that, Carlson. Get over here. Denny, give me one of those guns.
Who hit me?
I did.
You were so sure of yourself, Carlson, you never saw Miss Wynn lean out of the cabin porthole. Denny, go unlock that door and let Miss Wynn out.
Right, sir. If I may say so, sir, it's a great privilege to unlock the door for the guardian angel.
Are you all right, Isabel?
Yes, I'm fine.
Good. Denny, go down in the hold and pick up Miller. He'll be coming too just about now.
Right, sir.
Oh, and Denny.
Yes, sir.
I want to get Carlson and Miss Wynn back to shore. We'll take the Mary Ann. The rotor's still tied on at the landing steps. Bring Miller up and take him back with you in the rotor. Keep an eye on him, Denny. Keep a finger on your trigger.
I'll take good care of him, sir. See you later. Have a pleasant ride, Mr. Carlson.
Captain Drummond, did this man kill my father?
Yes, he and Miller. They did it together. Your father found out that Carlson was running more than an oyster house. That's why Carlson tried to buy him out.
And then when father wouldn't sell, he forced him on the roller coaster. But what?
because he was smuggling dirt.
That was it?
Yes. He brought the drugs into the Sound on his yacht and used the ride your father was operating as a blind for his smuggling. He landed his stuff on shore through the ride in the moonlight.
The ride in the moonlight?
Yes. One of his men, and perhaps a woman, to make it look like two people enjoying the ride, would buy a ticket, run the boat out through the tunnel into the Sound, and then they'd steer out to the yacht where the packages would be picked up.
I see. And in those packages?
Oysters.
Oysters?
Mm-hmm. Oysters packed with a drug. In case they were discovered in the process, those packages were very proper. Just a box of oysters bought at Carlson's Oyster Bar.
How did you find out about the ride in the moonlight?
Well, when we took our first ride, you remember the attendant said not to take the rotor, that she was out of order?
Yes, I do remember.
Well, I ran my hand across the motor. It was still hot. The boat was in good shape, and as I judged from the make of the motor, faster than the other boats. And then there was oil on the front of the boat.
Oil?
Yes, Carlson, oil. When we took that first ride, Isabel, and stayed in the lanes marked for the ride, our boat didn't pick up any oil. But the rotor had oil in her bow. Now, oil on the Sound can mean only one thing, a vessel. Carlson's yacht is the only vessel within half a mile. That was the last piece to the puzzle. The last piece but one.
What do you mean, the last but one?
The last question was how to get off Carlson's yacht with him pointing a gun at me. And you answered that one, Isabel.
With my good right hand.
When we've deposited our murderer here and Denny comes in with Miller, the ride in the moonlight will be restricted to couples interested exclusively in the moon.
Well, that's the way it was on January 14th, 1941. I'm Henry Chop, your host. Let me give you those couple reminders again. There's a link in this video if you want to check out our newspaper channel. No longer will the newspapers match the date on of the old-time radio upload, because I'm going to upload more frequently, and I'm also going to start in 1938 as well as doing 1941. About a week or so is when I hope to start that. But for the time being, I'm just going to do 1941. I'm getting those 1938 files in order. It'll take a little bit of a while. When I re-uploaded them, they kind of got jumbled up. And I do have them sorted by date, but I gotta get it all set up for you. It'll be a fascinating listen to go back over those once again. And also, we are on Facebook. So check out our Facebook page, go over there and like that. And I share a lot of stuff from other Facebook pages as well as my own posts on there. So I think you'll find it fascinating. Whenever a World War II veteran passes away, I do share that if it comes up in my regular news feed on Facebook. The Facebook page title is the World War II News and Old Time Radio Channels on YouTube. So I think you will find that very interesting. And let me give you an example of some of the things that are on there right now as I'm just perusing through the Facebook page. I have a famous picture of the Queen Mary bringing servicemen home from the war. I have a picture of an old roadhouse in Missouri in the late 1930s. And with an explanation of what the roadhouse is, these are from other pages that I just shared on here, other pages or groups. I have a picture of Miss Radio Queen of 1939. That is a kind of a humorous picture. And then I have a picture of an ad for television back in 1940. And then another picture of an old roadhouse. I have an article here about Soviet anti-tank dogs back in World War II. So some really, really cool stuff. I think you'll enjoy all of it. Oh, San Francisco 1943, a film about with that, driving down the road in 1943 in San Francisco. So just some cool stuff. Oh, a picture of what a typical wartime ration was in Great Britain. So You'll just enjoy that channel, the World War II News and Old Time Radio channel on YouTube. Check us out on Facebook. I think you'll enjoy that. And like that page. Subscribe to this one. Subscribe to our newspaper channel. Click on those bell icons. Let me tell you what we have coming up in the next upload. Let's see. We are going to have, The Adventures of Superman, then Jack Armstrong, the All-American Boy, as we spotlight January 15th, 1941, a Wednesday. Then we have The Lone Ranger, the Cavalcade of America, the Texaco Star Theater. Now, once again, we are going to have both the East Coast and West Coast versions of that program starring Fred Allen. Then we have an Eddie Cantor program, It's Time to Smile, and his guest is going to be Phil Harris from the Jack Benny program, his band leader. So some great vintage, man, we got a lot of great vintage radio. We certainly are making up from the lack of programs for January 14th with an abundance of programs recorded on January 15th. So just some great stuff. Until then, let's turn off this old tube radio that's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times, we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.